existential concerns. Nature is enough. We live in a wild universe unsupervised by any supernatural agent. What's it all about? Well, we don't know. It's not about anything, necessarily. You take all of existence, you can't assign meaning to it. We're here, we're making the best of it. It's a very curious situation indeed. No one in charge. Imagine that. There's no one in charge here. Well, comment. So we, but here, you go all the way out, no one in charge. We've got the grand, spectacular, weird story of science. What an inspiration. Fantastic stuff, Carl Sagan knew this. Astonishment, puzzlement, wonder. These are all natural responses to our very natural situation. Wow! Wow! I can't believe it. How very strange to be alive. Have you any of you woken up and felt this suddenly? Wow, something is here, something's going on. It didn't have to be. So naturalism can evoke feelings of self-transcendence and belonging. We are at home in the wild universe. We are at home. As strange as this place is, we are connected to it completely and utterly. And we're not going anywhere. But we're finding out about it. That's so cool. Death. There's no afterlife. No soul to continue on, but, and I got a, I think a pretty good paper about this at naturalism.org called Death, Nothingness, and Subjectivity. No nothingness after death. Anticipate what's going to happen when you die? What do you think is going to happen? It's not going to be blackness or emptiness. Very interesting question. We're thinking about it. But naturalism does not have all the answers. I'm happy to say that, otherwise I wouldn't be very dull. Maybe it's too interesting. We're trying to have an open society here where people hold different worldviews. How do we do this? This is a political question that naturalism doesn't have an answer to. Islam has an answer to it. Everyone must believe. Right? Naturalism, I don't want everyone to believe the same thing. What a dull world. The question of how we all get along is a terribly difficult one. The open democratic society where we one man, one vote, one vote. Yeah, that's a solution, but it's unstable. Moral dilemmas. I have to disagree with Sam Harris. Science does not have the answers to morality. There are moral dilemmas in which, because the values are basic and competing, we cannot ever have a fully satisfactory answer to the question. For instance, my selfish urge to treat myself to a lovely dinner versus my ethical obligation to send that money overseas to help someone. We all face these dilemmas every day, and there's no perfect answer, although Peter Singer gives 30% of his income to charity. But he's got tenure. These are tough questions. I don't have the answer to them, and no one, I think, does. And I think Harris is a little outside the, certainly outside the philosophical mainstream to suppose that science can determine human values. The hard problem of consciousness, this is probably my favorite puzzle around. Consciousness, the feeling of pleasure and pain, of sensory feelings, sight, vision. You are aware sitting, you've got these feelings and sensations, consciousness. We don't have a good science-based naturalistic story of why we are conscious. How does consciousness fit into the natural world? There's no received answer to that question out there. It's an extremely difficult question. I invite everyone to take a crack at what is called a hard problem of consciousness. Okay, what is your tough question for naturalism? Thanks. I do invite questions, just keep me, if you raise your hand, because we have a man in a green shirt back there, if you stretch your hand. Right there, good.
You mentioned rationalism several times in the discussion, saying that we are rational beings, wondering if you had any experience with data on the work with behavioral economics and the fact that we are not rational beings.
Very nice, yes. This has been coming up recently. The conscious mind is not fully in charge. We often act against our own self-interest. And the early and many other folks Ainsley, George Ainsley, has written a book called A Breakdown of Will, which gets into this as well. Behavioral economics shows us how we're constantly, speaking of undecidable questions, constantly trading off between our current selves and our future selves, right? Intersubjective, interpersonal conflict. So, what's the right, absolute right answer? Should I treat myself now or save for retirement? I'm in conflict with the future self. So, behavioral economics shows that we cannot be perfectly rational because there are competing interests there. I think that's what it shows. But yeah, rationality is operating on premises, on desires, as David Hume said. Reason is the slave to the passions, right? So, I'm passionate about myself, but I'm also passionate about my future self. They collide, so I don't know quite what to do, necessarily. So I'm not perfectly, optimally rational. Because I can't. Who had another question? I think I can reach it over.
You mentioned a few times resources. You mentioned that you had places where you had all this information available publicly. Those places, books, websites.
Sure. Oh, actually, here's a book I would like to show you. It's called The Myth of Free Will. I've got about 20 copies I'm going to give away by Chris Evett. This is not by me. So I'd like to give it to those who are most skeptical of the idea that really think they have free will. If you think you have free will, I want you to take this book home. If you're convinced, still use it, you can get it, but it's for the skeptics that I've written the book before. This is a little book called Encounter Naturalism. You can order it at naturalism.org. That's the website where this information is available. There's a huge amount there. It's been 10 years in the making. So this the archives are quite large. Sir?
I wonder how naturalism handles the problem of infinite regressions that plagues the theists. Your driver presumably will alter her subsequent behavior as a result of the ticket, but assuming that the cop is not an autonomous agent, his decision to give her a ticket must have been caused, and so on, turtles all the way down. We run up against the issue of ultimate cause, which theists, of course, say supports their contention that God is that.
Right. Well, this is one of the unanswerable questions. I mean, I think there's good evidence for causation. The ticket giver was fully caused in his ticket giving. That doesn't make it either right or wrong, though. We justify things as right or wrong by principles have nothing to do with causation. But as far as the infinite regress goes, I think we have to simply leave that question aside and be probably mystified. I certainly don't have an answer to why is, for instance, there's something rather than nothing. Philosophers explore this question. I haven't looked into it too deeply. As far as there being an ultimate cause, well, you're free to speculate, of course, but as far as the evidence goes, that's where I come down. No evidence either way that we can point to.
Tom, we have a question back here, actually.
All right.
I think as scientists, maybe you can impress us that things aren't black and white. Lots of shape of gray. You're not straight, you know, or gay, not male or female, that everything's a sliding scale. That I think with determinism, the PR downside of it is it lets people go, well, damn, I have no free will and I can't change a thing. And maybe on the encounter side, we live in a society, especially in America, that says you're poor, the probability of you ever getting out of your social classes is small. Hey, focus on that hope, that change, that's what you focus on. Do you feel maybe that in the PR aspect of determinism, if it was pitched more as predictivism, that we focus on the probability of free will versus your situation, that that's better for children trying to understand that you have maybe a really low probability getting out of your stance, and that's what you should focus on, but obviously the chance, call it free will or whatever, it still remains as low as that probability may actually be.
Right. We don't look at the people that determinism means that things don't change or can't change. They change all the time, and they change because of causation, right? So, and there is a probability that one can't rise above one's original status by working hard. But again, if people have a mind of a myth, they could do it no matter what their conditions. And this lets government off the hook. It lets us all off the hook in terms of range and circumstances, but they do have a probability of getting out of their circumstances. But you're right. Determinism is not a great word. It's got a lot of negative baggage. Causationism is one term that someone suggested. Cause and effect. I can't do that. It says 1 minute, 2 minutes. So yeah, the PR aspect of this is difficult, but I think it can be done simply by understanding that change does not require independence or freedom from causation. Change is built into causation, and by knowing how change happens, that gives us power. Anyone else? Oh, right there. And then
on the idea of empiricism as your source of knowledge, if we take a look at Francis Bacon, he said that our senses are not intact, our powers of reasons are not intact, which you agreed to. He says also nature is not a trustable source unless you poke it and prod it as part of your empirical process. Does that enter into where you get your does empiricism make you skeptical? What do you do? How do you know that you can trust nature?
Right. Well, that comes from repeated testing, which is the scientific method. You never do an experiment once. You do it several times. You control for as many variables as you can. You get your peer group to review it. And that is how you get reasonably sure, not completely sure, of course, that nature is behaving the way she really does. But you can never be completely sure. So yeah, we don't want to get too high on the horse, but of course that's the point of science, it's self-correcting. And we have a couple of about 3 seconds.
Do we have an ethical obligation to uphold natural facts that have a strong probability of causing greater utility?
We shouldn't indulge in the naturalistic fallacy, which is to suppose that because something is the case, that therefore it should be. I'm not sure I quite understood your question.
I'm just wondering, if you as a scientist or a researcher were to find out facts about our mental state that could cause harm, do you have an ethical obligation to withhold them?
That's an interesting moral question, and I don't have a good answer to it. Again, there are things in tension, right? Wanting not to do harm, and then wanting to know the truth. Mm-hmm. The truth about free will may be just such a question.
That's what I'm thinking.
Hey Tom, if you can, let's take an extra 30, 45 seconds and answer the gentleman I've been waiting to ask a question.
After our having heard this talk, some of us may act more in accordance with the principles that you've laid out than we would have previously, and some of us may not.
The principles of what?
Well, you've given us some advice, haven't you?
Yep.
Okay.
The principles I've laid out. Okay, yeah.
Yeah. So what I'm saying is that some of us may do things more in accordance with what you say, and some of us may not. But none of us will have any choice in the matter, correct?
No, because we are choice-making creatures. Deliberating and choosing is what we do as human beings. Right now, you're thinking about what I've said. You're weighing in your mind. That's what we do. You can't help but make a choice about what you believe tonight.
But our conclusion is foregone.
We don't know what your conclusion is going to be. I don't know.
No, but it's
that's
fine.
I'm talking because I want to spread the meaning of naturalism. I don't know if it's going to get spread or not. I'm talking in order to make it spread. Right? That's a choice. It's all coming out of who I am in this situation. So even though things I'm saying are fully caused, our choice making, our actions all remain as they in a sense, they're just as powerful, they're just as effective. And because we don't know what's going to happen, therefore we act. If we were gods, we'd have no reason to behave because we would know the future. We don't know the future. The future is epistemically closed. It might be metaphysically closed. But I'm sorry, I said it completely wrong. The future is epistemically open. That is, we don't know what's going to happen. It might be metaphysically closed, but it's epistemically open. We act as if and because our actions make a difference in the world. They make just as much of a difference as anything else. So there's no invitation to passivity or fatalism in any of this. We gain power, we gain control, we gain compassion. That's how I see it anyway.
Thank you.
Thank you.